Hi, Jeff.
Hi. Guy, that's more like it. So, secure remoting. I initially was planning on a session of building a whole remoting environment. I changed it a little. First of all, I think you kind of figured that out already. Who hasn't? Come on, Lee. So, if you don't know how to do it, RTFM, that should work. Instead, I recently been at three separate customers where I discovered the situation where they implemented remoting, fully automated, and they thought they were secure. They weren't. So I'll show you why, and I'll show you how you can fix that. So about me, we can skip. What we will cover, remoting over the internet. In my investigation, when remoting was just possible, I found a blog article from somebody that kind of rubbed me the wrong way. And I'll show you also why. Who, what to trust with remoting. So from a security perspective, I will say trust nobody. Who trusts anybody? You're all feeling being very paranoid, you know that, right?
We all watch X-Files.
X-Files, trust no one, yes. So credentials, secure. Well, it depends on how you use them. So in the case of those customers, security, yeah, right. And implementing secure remoting, that can be done. And Windows offers natively a lot of stuff in the OS and in PowerShell that will enable you to do that. What we won't cover, this. If you want to cover that, read the manual. So, remoting over the internet. I would say use PowerShell Web Access. The thing was built for it. If you're not, maybe you want to use a VPN connection or direct access for that matter, but that's over the internet. Maybe the idea is you don't have that possibility, and maybe it's the environment of a customer if you're a system integrator. In that case, PowerShell Web Access. That has my preference. Then, about a year, one and a half year ago, I found an article about by Christian Heinzmann. Does anybody know the guy? Too bad. Because he written quite a long article. Now, a lot of investigation went in there. And his solution was basically this. So what he did was trusted hosts. As in, who do you trust? Well, everybody. He's optimistic. Second, firewall. Disable it. Import certificate. A certificate basically says, well, you can trust this and this and this and this. And in the context of everybody. Basically Swiss cheese. Then you can enable the firewall again, so it's secure. And you're done. And that's publicly facing the internet. No alarm bells? Anybody? Not even Lee? So I see a blue hat t-shirt over there. They're gonna love this. Yep. So again, I'll show you it is possible to do it properly. My preference, PowerShell remoting. In case of PowerShell remoting on the internet to on the device directly connected to the internet, if you don't know where you're connecting from, you have to trust everybody. The end target will need to know what to trust, where you're coming from. So some system administrators have put their home IP address in there. Yes, I've seen them. Not so much the best solution, I would think. Who has a static IP at home? Okay. Who has actually reserved that static IP forever? So whenever you would move homes, chances are that you won't have the same IP. So will you remember to change that? Or at least actually change it and not add your new IP address to it? So chances are that if somebody gets your old IP address, they won't know where to use it. but it's still a risk. So, who or what to trust? Trusted hosts you can configure with this command. Well, what's wrong with this?
Start.
Yeah, it kind of makes me cry. So you can specify multiple values, and yes, you can use wildcards. So you can authorize an entire subnet. And in my case, the customer, the IT department has a specific subnet. And even within that subnet, there are only a few IP addresses where the actual IT admins are. So the more you specify, the more secure it will become. It's not totally secure yet. Yeah.
This is like execution policy. It's like your own seatbelt. It's not sort of preventing any attacker to go to that system, right?
Correct. This is a little bit. The question was: this is like execution policy. This is your own seatbelt. Correct. But it begins with that.
Of course.
Because that's why just enough admin was there. You are an attack surface. And currently at my company, I am still an attack surface because I'm everything at the company. Domain admin, enterprise admin, asterisk admin, basically.
It's not very secure.
No, I want to remove my own permissions preferably, but currently I still need them. And that's why we're implementing DSC with just enough admin. And once we're done, I hope to be able to be just a user. That's the main goal. That's like, how do you call it? Utopia?
Jeff, I also see in a lot of companies that they're using stepping stones or Citrix servers for management. Yeah, that's also use cases.
Stepping stones or hub servers for management. Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah, that's. But that's also publicly facing. So.
No, not necessarily.
Not necessarily. Okay, that's a good implementation. Behind the firewall or.
Just internally, also you need a VPN into it.
Yes. Oh, so. What?
Can you repeat the comments so we can get them?
Sometimes you have a hub server that's not directly connected to the internet, but privately. So IT management admins use that server to connect to, and from that server, they perform the administration tasks. And that. Before DSC, maybe when DC until DC becomes more bigger and more adapted, I think that's probably the way to go for now. So what's the problem with remoting? Always the users, specifically their authentication. Where do you get your credentials from? Is it a certificate, username, password, combination, fingerprint, retinal, DNA? Anybody? Who uses only credentials? That's it? No. Come on. Or RSA tokens? Certificates?
RSA tokens and a VPN.
Okay. RSA tokens and VPN. Okay. So, in my opinion, authentication is the problem. So a lot of companies, and including those three customers, were using only credentials, using a password. So where do you store them? Or better yet, if you have one credential and you want to use that credential for multiple scripts, how do you use them? And even better, do you have a third-party solution for it? There are some third-party security vaults that can integrate with scripts even. So what you can say is that security vault, well, I have this credential stored, this and this and this user can access it. And when they run this script and it pops up for a credential, the client from the security vault will see it on the local system and will automatically fill in the credentials. It is possible. They're very expensive. So let's take a quick look at credentials, or specifically PS credentials. Can anybody hear me, by the way, or do I have to?
We can see.
Oh. There we go again. Also remoting through SSL. And I'm guessing most of you can actually read the code. So it's basically copy-paste, change a few values, and you're set to go. I'm currently using this for new PCs. No system at our environment is using no SSL for PowerShell remoting. Lee talked about that yesterday, I believe, that AD communication Kerberos.
Use CRUD SSP, for example, to encrypt your sessions.
You can.
Kerberos to encrypt the sessions, even over HTTP.
I believe you can, actually.
So I guess there's really two ways to think about it. If there's a domain trust between the two computers that are connecting, you don't need SSL. But if you're doing cross-domain or within a work group, then you don't need SSL for the encryption aspect, but you do need something to help you guarantee the name of the computer you're connecting to.
Yeah, of course.
And so the SSL will help you identify name in those situations, but the encryption is already handled by the WinRM protocol, regardless of the transport.
So
cross-domain, and you have trust between two domains, and you have trusted hosts in certain domains, your trusted host sites, will there still be Kerberos application going on? Different forests, even, and they have a forest trust. Will that still work?
If you can connect to that machine, so the question was, if I can connect cross domains that are trusted, will PowerShell protect that as well? And if you can do things like access a network share on behalf of that user, then that will also work with PowerShell remoting.
So for the people viewing at home, quick recap from what just happened. If you have two separate forests, or two separate domains, does Kerberos do auto-authentication? And don't you need SSL? If there's a trust between the domains, and you can actually connect to those two, the domain will handle all the authentication, and you won't need SSL. In case of my current company's environment, we're hosting our own development environment, our NT environment, test, acceptation, but also for each customer we have a demo environment, training environment, production, acceptation, test, etc. All of those are separate domains and even forests. There's something to do with certifications, so those have to be separate. And that's where we basically decided, well, we can choose that internally that we won't need maybe an SSL connection. Where I'm more into consistency, and then yes, maybe we'll hit some performance issues in there, performance pain, but we basically enabled it everywhere. Good.
Yeah, do you use the script only for the non-domain systems? Because for domain systems, I would choose to use GPO to keep it.
We're not using GPO.
Sorry?
We're not using GPO.
Yeah, that's my question.
So would you be able to configure it through GPO? Partially, yes. I don't know if it's Lee. If it's fully possible through the GPO. Don't think so.
I don't remember.
No.
Yeah, you can. I think so.
I hear yes, you can.
Yeah, you can. You can even set the trust host and the WSMan items. You can do the fresh credential delegation. I think it's called. So there's system. You can do all these settings via group policy. The only trick is I was playing with SMA 212,
yeah,
the service management automation. And if you set your WinRM policy for PowerShell remoting, it breaks SMA. So you have to exclude that server from your group policy settings. It's
so
like when there are already remoting settings on the machine before you install it.
So, okay. So setting it through a group policy on an SMA machine will break SMA?
Yeah,
that's gotta hurt.
There's no secure, security storage weird error when you start the runbook worker service, and if you remove all your remoting security settings for PowerShell remoting, reinstall the runbook service, it works again.
Okay, so don't know your name, but somebody in the audience just told us it's possible. So again, you can basically copy paste this. Where we go? Here we go. Password. So I read the host as a secure string. And yes, I'm getting to using the actual get credential. No worries. My password. Who thinks this is secure?
No.
Is there a yes in the room? You're both right and wrong, by the way. But and saying that to Jeffrey Snowden must be dangerous, but so secure password is a secure string. When you take a look, where are we? There we are. What I'm doing here is taking this secure password and extract it. That's my password. This can only be done from the user that actually created this. So there is security in there.
On that machine.
On that machine. That too, by the way. Yes. So this customer had one, maybe two user accounts that created all the credentials. That user account had some generic password everybody knew. And everybody that actually wanted to use a credential in the script used that credential they knew to decrypt the password they didn't know. And that was automatically inserted into the script. Well, if you actually pause the script or debug the script and took a look inside a variable, there was the password, plain text. And this was a 32-character randomly generated password, because that's secure. So think about this before you actually do it. If that one or two user accounts were get hacked, you're seriously screwed. So then customer two came along. They had a system where they were using GUIDs to identify the password with the user account. So there were two tables, all GUIDs. The GUIDs matched, so then the username and the password matched. That's pretty secure, right? Anybody? So let's take a look. If I can get my hands on one half of the list, the passwords, and I'm a member of the domain, that's all I need to be. I can use LDAP to query your domain, get all the user accounts, and who can write a script to test this user account with all those passwords? Only four people? Come on! So, secure? And then I came along this. Well, let's use get credential for once. Here, I have my password. What? I see somebody, I hear somebody laughing. Why? This is not funny yet. So, I'm creating a file. I'm getting the content. Does not exist. Good morning. Yeah.
It's not one again.
And this is supposed to be my secure password. So when I take a look in this file, it is actually just a bunch of characters, right? You can't use this. And still the case. That's my password. So as long as you are able to put it in a secure string, you can easily get the password again. So whatever method you use to encrypt it, as long as it becomes a secure string, you can get it. And there we go. Shared passwords via a key. So this somewhat leans towards the solution of the customer that created a separate account to create the passwords and read the passwords, where everybody knew the credentials from that account. So let's clear the plain text password, make it secure. Let's take a look again. Yeah, still a secure string. And here we have a key. This key can be anything you like. So this is used to encrypt your password. We go there. Encrypt the password. Let's take a look again. Just to be sure. Yeah, remove it, because it was still there. There it is again. Unreadable. So far, so good. Where was my get content? There we go. 1, 2. Incorrect format. Any take us on why? Okay, everybody's awake. So the idea from this is to that you're able to use this, give the key to your colleagues, and they can use it to decrypt. So let's become a colleague. Yeah, just a second. I'm sorry. Can anybody read this actually? Just a little bit of red. So it says, convert to string. Input string was not in the correct format. Oh, correct, because we are not using the key. So let's do that. Cannot bind argument to parameter string because it's null. Of course, my key. Still not the case.
The file is also here on the same location?
Yeah, it's on the same location.
Yeah, and accessible.
It didn't select the key. Select line 6 and 7.
I did.
Oh, you did it. Okay,
yeah. I'm not as blonde as I look.
Execute
96. Secure password. Made a typo. Bet me. Oh well. Anyway, you're supposed to be able to use this key to pass the credentials to anybody. If this key is, well, this key is still plain text, you can use a secure key. Even the key is encrypted. So, how far will you go to enable security? That's the question, basically.
Don't you have to put content in there?
I did. Okay, from top to bottom. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah, but line 2 generates an error, right? So secure password doesn't get.
But line 7 should have content instead of secure password, right?
Yeah.
Am I that dumb? Toby to the rescue! So now I have secure password, there we go again, and whoop, that's my password.
Thank you.
So going back to me. And normally it takes just a few seconds, they would say. This is something the third customer did. They created three functions: get password and new password. This basically does the same thing. It encrypts the password, stores it into a text file, which you can read again. So that brings me to my question. In the text file, then you can use it. And we're still discussing whether or not to use the GUID to identify. But then, for me, that's a little bit like fake security. That's a lot of work, overhead, and why? So, just to be safe, set NTFS permissions on the file for that specific user or specific users that want to use that password.
You're storing it with a key?
What?
You're storing the password then with a key, so if the credentials are need to be used by different users,
yeah.
The option is to store it with a key. Then you have to store that key somewhere, and in my opinion, the username computer combination is still safer than a central key. You have to.
This is still leading towards the username computer stuff.
Okay.
You can only use this key with the specific user that created it from the computer you created the file from.
Yeah.
So it's leaning on the mechanism that's already in place.
Did you consider using some kind of, because we're wrestling with this too, and you consider using some kind of database backend?
No.
Because you have this issue about where you're going to how you're going to secure the key. So if you need some kind of black box solution that that the users don't, you need a line that no one else can cross, right?
I would think about using a database. In the past, this customer had serious issues with databases where they were corrupted, and there anything that crucial they don't want to store in a database. But also
which database were they?
Yeah, but also they're even Switzer. But even the file share, they're not allowing to dedupe. As simple as that, dedupe. Because it in theory it could go corrupt and then the passwords aren't reachable.
We've had this thing with the file, and then you can end up with locking issues around the file. When you go to update it, it can become a whole, you can have more fun occurring there when it comes time to update.
Yeah. Oh. We're not thinking about it. If you do, please blog about it and share. Wait a second.
Yeah, and it also depends on the situation, what you're trying to achieve. Because I've mainly seen these kind of stuff when you're trying to do scheduled tasks.
We're getting to that.
Yeah, and how we did it before was the person that set it up, he set it up, and then the password is split among, by example, two persons, so that one person isn't able to do something on their own. So you make it more of a procedural solution.
Yeah, so procedures are key in this, any way you do it. Even with DSC and just enough admin, it's a procedure in the background.
Yeah.
And Jeffrey basically scripted around that.
So yeah, but like I said, it doesn't need to be a technical solution. It can be a procedural solution.
Indeed, technical, every time in IT basically, IT is just a tool. And if the business processes are faulty, incorrect, then IT can do anything they want and it still be able to screw it up. Toby.
You're talking about scheduled tasks, right?
Later I'm going to mention it about. But
I just want to toss in, if you want to decouple the secret from the user, sometimes that's what you want. You have a normal user and he needs to do protected stuff. And then one of the things in the past that was used a couple of times was to use scheduled tasks as the escrow agent who's sort of keeping the secret so that the normal user wouldn't need that. So when you add a script to a scheduled task and then you make the normal user trigger that task over an event trigger, then it's easy for them to trigger.
So you're basically going to use scheduled tasks to store the username and password.
To launch a script under a different account.
Yeah, but you would have to enter the credentials once when you create the task.
That's right.
So in that case, you may want to take a look at a session from, I believe, Marcus Murray or Paula Juniskevich, where they show you that's not secure.
Well, anything that you put on a machine can be, of course, a good ways of getting back to that. Then you can do anything.
I think it's...
In order.
Your question, but I work for a bank, and we are we have to change our passwords every now and then. If you use this method, it can be quite cumbersome to get around all these credential files and stuff, because then you have to make a test credential script to see if the credential file is still valid, not forward away, create new ones, and it can be quite cumbersome to manage all these credential files.
Well, yes and no. There's a trick for that. Did you know that with a pool server in DSC, you can create a checksum? Use the same mechanism.
Yes.
Then you know when the file's changed.
We are working with one of those overpriced storage credentials. We have to, because of all sorts of regulations now with banking issues. So
yep.
But we now have to create a script, because they changed the password. So then I have to make a script from the password vault, which checks the credential file, removes it, runs under the user, creates a new credential file so my scheduled task can still work. So it's totally developing your story all because of these password management tools. Because there are rules and regulations and all sorts of stuff. It's going to be quite tricky to handle all these things.
I'll get back to that a little bit in the takeaways at the end, but now Lee.
One of the things that I'm finding a bit hard to kind of understand is when it comes to security, it's always contextual, right? So.
Yeah.
When you're saying, hey, I just entered a credential, and now if I can decrypt it in memory, that's unsecure. Or if I can pop a file server, you can see credentials, and that might be unsecure. But the example of I can decrypt a credential in memory is, you know, the attack there is your admin falls asleep drunk, leaves his keyboard open, unlocked, attacker comes in, or he's got, you know, some exploit of a Word doc or something else. So if that's not an attack you're worried about, that's completely secure.
Yeah.
Now, if we're talking about the security of a file share where credentials might be held, then you have to worry about what happens if that machine gets popped, and there's a bunch of different ways that can go well and go bad. So there is no just absolute secure or insecure. It's all about what they call the threat model, about who are your attackers, what are the trust boundaries, and what are the domains.
I'm going to stop you because I'm getting back to that, actually. There was another. Okay. Well, shared credentials, like I said, preferably use secure keys instead of keys. In my case, at least, preferably. So, this is a solution I found on the internet for service accounts. They're basically doing a little bit of the same. So, again, this becomes a secure string, and only in the context from the person and device you created it from, you can decrypt it. So the takeaways, and that's number one actually, create content based on context. So the content is the password, secure or not, whatever, and it's all about the context. And Lee was already mentioned that, but the attack vector, there's a whole schema about it where you can say, well, we have this, then we have this attack vector. So are you using this, anybody? Two people? except for lead maybe. So is that an NSA document? I don't know, so, but I don't know the author of the document, or the threat model. Anybody? Jeffrey, maybe? The threat model, where they say, well, this situation with this situation makes this threat model.
Oh, no, that's everybody. You do your own.
You do your own. Okay. Think in segments. So even with service accounts, a service account does one thing. That's it, if you're using it correctly. So at a Dutch government agency, we managed to figure out that the config manager service account was local admin on all the machines. And we found out that the local support guys get their hands on that credential. So we were never seeing local support logging in anymore. Just a lot of config manager admin service accounts.
Bad configuration.
Yeah. Yes, bad configuration. And you can simply use a group policy on that service account, on those service accounts, to deny logon interactively if your application supports it. Test it, of course. So security versus usability, that's always the case, I believe. And scripted. Who has ever had a customer, maybe in the past, that had a paper next to his screen with all the usernames and passwords, etc., or an Excel sheet, or anybody?
Excel sheet.
Yeah. Excel.
Text file.
Text file. So, if you can script it, do so. And depending on what industry you are, we had one guy over there that works in the financial industry, and they're paying a lot of money for a solution that this does this automatically. So you can, but maybe you don't need to. And maybe you don't need to in specific environments. If your internal environment has no internet connection whatsoever, maybe you can be a little bit flexible in this. Any questions? Toby?
Not really a question, a discussion. Like, it is all a matter about who keeps the secret, right? So if I encrypt something, no matter how hard I encrypt it and where I store it, in Windows there's no differentiation between read-write, the privilege to read something, and to execute.
Mm-hmm.
So if the same person wants to get to the secret, like we've seen with the secure string, then of course the secret is shared and there's no protection.
Yeah.
Now, the thing with the scheduled task would be one system where I can decouple the secret from the user of the secret. And I was wondering who else has experience with setups where you really differentiate, where the secret is not in the hands of the person who is actually consuming it.
And am I allowed to mention product names? Okay. I know of one product called Arc Vault, I believe. And that's not cheap. But it has a client on the system, terminal server, desktop, laptop, whatever. And in ArcVault you say, well, you are allowed to use this credential in this context. And the client will automatically figure it out. Hey, you want to do this. Here you go. Here are the credentials.
Okay. Had you considered using the run-as endpoints
for some of this? We're working on that, but that hasn't been finished yet. Using endpoints, runners endpoints, yeah.
That's great, by the way. But is it also limited to being a local admin?
Nope.
But it's great. We did.
That's why I like it.
Yeah.
Does it use runners in a lot of endpoints? I read that if you use runners on a machine, anyone with local administrator rights can read the password from memory, except on Windows 8.1 and 2012 R2. Then it was fixed. But on all the systems before that, you can still not fix. I'd rather just store it in memory now encrypted, but it still goes in plain text.
Trust me, fake security.
Huh? Once anybody logs into a machine,
yeah.
If that machine is compromised, it's compromised. So there's just enough admin stuff that Jeffrey was going to talk about today thoughts about how to limit the scope of that compromise?
We have some issues with some internal security systems in fact that you can decrypt. Well, we have an audit from an external company, and they were granting local administrator rights on the machine, and I could read all the passwords from anybody who uses a run ads with an admin account on a box.
So basically what you want to do is, I'll talk a lot about this in my talk,
yeah.
What you can do is you can set up an endpoint with a well-defined set of actions, and then say run ads, and if you give domain credentials, like the domain account, what you want to do is you want to set up like one or two machines with that and treat them like domain controllers, right? Just to say, secure the heck out. Like, watch those things securely. And because if they get cracked, you can harvest the credentials and you're using high-value credentials.
There's a guy out there, I believe it's a Win Debugging, or debugging, he's a website. If you're into kernel debugging, go there, where he shows you how to, you can rather easily extract just about any password from the currently logged on users from a kernel memory dump. Full dump, by the way. Not mini dump.
With Mimikatz, probably. With Mimikatz.
Nope. WinDBG.
But there's also something similar with Mimikatz, and also you have to keep in mind with virtualization solutions. Yeah, it's the same as with the domain controllers. You have to secure them in a similar way. And I see companies that don't do that. They say, okay, our DC is trusted, but yeah, somewhere in the world someone is administering the virtual infrastructure. So yeah, they don't think about that as well.
It's a little bit beyond remoting, but there's a Dutch guy called Remco Wijnen. He's crazy brilliant, by the way. He has written a script in, I believe, even PowerShell, where he extracts admin passwords from VHD files, VHDX from the VMware version of those files. If you can get your hands on the file, you can get the password.
It's the same case with the domain controller. If you can get your hands on the database, that's why you protect your servers.
Yes.
Physically as well as mentally.
Yeah. And who has ever put a plain text password in the property of a user account? Please say no. I see your finger. No!
Well, you can set the access rights on the property of the user account, and you can store secrets within it, so only a certain user can access.
Well, I'm a freelancer. You can hire me, and I will find it for you.
Sure.
So, no. Even a plain user account with LDAP can get so much information from your Active Directory, you get scared.
Yeah, still, it's risky also. So you give someone, by accident permission, he gets all the passwords.
Okay. I'm done. Oh, wait. Yeah!